Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Wonderful to see you. I have a pre-service devotion today. I'm going to talk about it a little bit later on, but I use the daily texts of the Moravians, and the one they chose for today is a little bit odd, but I'm going to talk about it anyway. It's Isaiah 58:1. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion. Now, I'm sure if I asked anybody in this room, you would know what your star sign was. Most of us have probably been told certain characteristics that apply to people of our sign. For example, I'm a Taurus, and every time I read about Tauruses, I see that I'm supposed to be stubborn. There are other things that I'm often told about myself based on my star sign, that I'm reliable, which is questionable, that I'm practical, even less questionable. But the word stubborn is the one that most often pops up, so fine, I'm stubborn. Now, if we want to go a step beyond the basics, we can also read our horoscope every day. Depending on who has written the horoscope, it can vary wildly from one written in the same about the same sign on the same day according to whatever newspaper or online source you're reading. Some people are so into this sort of thing that they pay a lot of money to have a horoscope drawn up especially for them based on a lot more specific information than just the time of year they were born. They also go by the exact time of day and the exact location, maybe other things, I don't know. Now, as far as I'm concerned, horoscopes are a lot like Halloween. They're kind of fun occasionally, but nothing a Christian should delve into too deeply. Whether or not the spirits behind these things are real, and I will not say one way or the other, our obsession with them can, if we're not careful, become all too central to our belief system. And so I kind of wonder at those Christians who place too much trust in the impact that the movements of the stars and the planets have over their lives. For me, it's enough to trust in the Creator of those heavenly bodies and to believe that true freedom is to be found in dependence on God. And the closing scripture appointed for today is from Galatians 4:9. Now, however, that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and beggarly elemental spirits? How can you want to be enslaved to them again? There's a very ancient hymn called the Te Deum, and I'd like to close this devotion with the final line of that hymn. Let us pray. O Lord, in thee have I trusted. Let me never be confounded. Amen. Now let's settle in and listen to a very special prelude prepared for us by our bellboy.
Thank you. morning.
Good morning.
I know it's cold outside, but I hope you'll find the warmth of the fellowship and the worship more than offset it. I'd like to welcome everybody who's here and everybody who's at home. We are disciples of Christ, a movement for wholeness in a fragmented world. United in spirit and inspired by God's grace, we love all, and seek justice for all. May the peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
We have a lot of announcements today. I'll do all the housekeeping ones first. There are masks in the narthex if you choose to use one. Our offering plate is located on the table just inside the sanctuary. As you know, we are not passing the offering plate anymore. Prayer requests will be collected and brought to Sam during the children's message. Please be sure to sign a few pads so that we know we're here. We have one of other little things today. I'd like to thank Stephanie Burke and Mary Wick for the beautiful decorations on the altar that will remain through Thanksgiving. After the service today, there will be fellowship, including waffles. And I'll cheer. And we will be making little homemade do-it-yourself Advent wreaths. Even if you don't want to make one for yourself, it'd be great if you come down and make one for someone who is not able to come to church. We are going to be delivering them to people who are shut in or are not, you know, comfortable leaving their house right now. Something new that we're going to be instituting is something we call Minute for Missions. We're going to be doing that, although Ross is in charge of this, so we all know it's going to last more than a minute. But she's going to keep us updated on the important missions that we are participating in this church in service to the Lord. We are going to have our annual chili dinner in conjunction with the tree lighting on the square this year. That's going to be Thursday, December 2nd from 5 to 6:30 p.m. There are two pieces of paper on the bulletin board downstairs just as you enter the fellowship hall where you can sign up to donate food. And there are little reminder slips that you can pick up to write yourself a note to remember to bring it. We'd like to have food here by 4 o'clock. We will definitely need help with, you know, setup, serving, and cleanup. There are flyers, you know, that look like this out there. So if any of you want to take any of them and post them or take them anywhere you work or somewhere like that to advertise this, that would be great. One note on Christmas shopping, I know that, you know, those of you who plan are probably thinking about that already, and although we have this in our bulletin every week, I wanted to make mention of it. If you're buying things from Amazon, if you buy from smile.amazon.com and designate the church to receive donations, a percentage, a very, very small percentage of your purchase is returned to the church by Amazon. We do take some money in that way every year. It does add up, so keep that in mind. You can buy all the same stuff, it's all the same price. Not everything is eligible for donation, but most things are. So it's a way to help out the church without even spending any money. Are there any other announcements that anybody wants to make? I think that's enough, don't you? All right, so Russ, we'll turn it over to you for your minutes for missions.
Moment.
Okay.
Association at the Family Life Center in Bainbridge, which is, I think, connected with the federal was so excited about it, I wanted to share with you. And whenever a door closes, that opens a window. At our last missions meeting, we were bemoaning the fact that a collection for the soon-to-be-arriving Afghan refugees went missed. They closed before we even knew about it. Well, what do you know? People in Geauga County said, a lot of good people out here, a lot of people who want to do something, even though the refugees will be housed in Cleveland near bus lines. We have a chance to help with the Welcome Kettle Project. The Welcoming Kettle is always, there's always tea. Whenever I go visit Sharifa and Asia, there's always tea. When the government people in Afghanistan are meeting, they meet over tea. So we're invited to join the Welcoming Kettle. There's a list of all kinds of things they need, new or almost new used, but in good condition. And they're looking also for volunteers out at the Family Life Center on the days that things are being collected. So if you like to do that kind of thing, the times and dates are here. We can collect things through December 18th. I think Bill and Linda are gonna figure out somewhere in the church to keep it. But you can, if you have big things, you can drive it yourself out 306. So I just, the person that spoke was April Carson. She's a young woman from Bainbridge who is a humanitarian attorney. Her husband's in the military and they've been many places. The last assignment they had was in Afghanistan, and she was there when the government fell, and there were people right there at the airport calling to say, can you get papers for this person that has to get out of here before they're beheaded? So she had a lot to tell us. I really hope it's recorded so that I can give you the link and you can hear. She told all about the history of Afghanistan and how the women got the right to vote in 1964. So that's going down the drain. Anyway, she told us about the geography of the country and how many different kinds of tribes and people live there and what wonderful, kind people they are. Maybe not what we've read about in the news and so forth. And that when they come with nothing. Sharifa and Asia came with some personal belongings. These people will come with nothing, and they have no credit. They don't have credit in Afghanistan. They want to have credit records. So they're going to need jobs. They're going to need families to adopt them and work with them. Not necessarily financially at all, but to help them. And when we started working with Sharifa and Asia, believe me, it was scary. How do you talk to people that can't speak English? What do you do for them? And then it gets, sometimes it's frustrating. You want them to do what you want them to do, but they're people, and they know what's best for them or what they want. And then you're just kind of falling in love. So you might want to consider thinking about fostering a family as well. This will be on the bulletin board, and thank you so much. This is such a kind, loving church. I appreciate being able to do this and being part of this family.
One other announcement, and you can check with Linda on this. I believe that the food for Thanksgiving family donation is still downstairs, correct?
There's a few things left.
If you'd like to sign up to help with that. Okay, if there's nothing else, then please rise in body or spirit for the call to worship.
presence of abiding love, we enter God's presence with awe.
Lead us, Lord, in your righteousness. Make your way known to us.
May all who take refuge in God be filled with joy.
And may God's protection be spread over us, that we may exalt in God's holy name.
Please remain standing as we sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, stanzas 1 and 4 of page 2 of your handbook. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
kids that want to come forward for the children's message, it's time. Those of you who have a prayer request, you can write it down, send it up to the deacon, and it will be remembered later.
Good morning, everybody.
Church would be taken up by bell choir tables, and you'd have to somehow get through them to conduct the service, and then it came time for the bell choir to play, and you could not possibly recognize a tune. And so every time I hear Hours, I'm always so thankful. I mean, not only do I recognize the tune, but it's good. So I have an awful lot of prayer requests today. So let me share them with you, and by the end of the prayer we'll have a silence instead of at the beginning. Jenny Gillis's uncle Mike Tusai found out on Thursday that he has a mass on his pancreas, and he has to visit an oncologist tomorrow, so please remember Mike in your prayers. Is Bobby Campbell still in ICU?
No, he's out.
He's out.
Yeah, he's in a regular room.
He's in a regular room. Okay, so Bobby Campbell has COVID, and he was in ICU, but apparently he's improving, and he's out of ICU. That's the second one. We want to be thankful for all the good, kind, compassionate, helpful people out there, which of course we do. One of our members is very thankful to God for his guidance and the Holy Spirit that helped him prepare his home for winter with insulation, etc. And when I read that, I think we should all be thankful as winter approaches that we do have a warm place to retreat to when it's cold. Don would like for us to pray for his brother Jim. He's having knee surgery on Tuesday, and we want to pray also for his wife Nancy, that she will be kept safe and calm and peaceful through that. I understand Kenny Temple fell on Wednesday. I don't know how Kenny's doing. I just found that out. So let's pray for Kenny. One big bit of news. We need to pray for Cindy Hopkins. Her mother, Billy Sudik, died, I think, just this morning. So I know Billy has been very ill with Alzheimer's for quite a while, and I think we can be thankful that she's at peace, but also I'm sure Cindy needs our prayers at this time. We want to pray for strength and peace for Sarah Bauer. Roz's brother-in-law, Roger, who's had foot surgery on a foot that was good. He did have the other foot partially removed. So we want to pray for Roger that he'll soon be able to put pressure on the foot that was operated on. Carolyn Mara was having some problem with her back and leg, so let's keep Carolyn in our prayers. Roz's grandson, Quinn, we need to pray for him to find the right medication to deal with some of his problems. And she's going to Chicago tomorrow. So we want to pray for traveling mercies for her.
Today.
Oh, today. She told me she wouldn't be here today, and so I'm very confused to see her. I think maybe she was telling me she wouldn't be here the whole time. So, and very thankful that Roz's son Brian got a job. He's a librarian at SUNY Potsdam. So let's remember all of those requests, and I'm sure everybody here has things in your own heart, on your own mind, that you want to pray for. So let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Loving God, we thank you for your goodness and your love toward us. We thank you for the hope, for the joy of home and family, for the companionship of friends and neighbors, for the activities that bring fulfillment to our lives, for the strength that supports us and the love that surrounds us, both when our joy is complete and when it is touched by pain. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, for the glory of his humble birth, for the graciousness of his selfless life, for the obedience and trust that led him to the cross, and for the triumph of his resurrection and his ascension. We give thanks for the Holy Spirit, the Spirit that is at work both in your church and in our hearts, revealing your truth, renewing our lives, and bringing us to the new Jerusalem. God of love and power, we pray now for this congregation and for your church throughout the world, that through the courage and faith of your people, your word may be proclaimed and your gospel lived. We pray also for all those who are in trouble. We pray for those that are sick, that they may find care and healing, that those who are lonely may find love, that the oppressed may be strengthened, that those who mourn may be comforted, and that those who are at this moment facing death, may they know and trust in your risen Son, Jesus. In silence, hear now the prayers that we offer to you from the depths of our hearts. All this we offer to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, God forevermore. Amen.
Our scripture this morning is from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 18 through 25. Where there is forgiveness, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I don't know what version of the Bible you prefer. There probably are some of you out there this morning who prefer to read the authorized, that is, the King James Version of the Bible. You like tradition. You like the dignity of that translation. You find the language beautiful. And nowhere is this more the case than in the book of Psalms. I know that the Psalms were originally written in Hebrew, but somehow reading them in the King James Bible makes me feel more like I'm reading them in the original language. So beautiful do I find it. But things with the KJV are not always so rosy. And one of the problem areas we find with the translation is when we open our Bibles to what most modern translations simply refer to as the letter to the Hebrews. Now, Hebrews is just a name that we have given it. It doesn't call itself the letter to the Hebrews, but it does open with these words. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. If the first words are intended to tell us to whom the letter was written, then clearly it was the people whose ancestors God spoke to through the prophets, namely the Hebrew people. But if you open your King James Bible to that same page, the one that opens the book of Hebrews, you're often likely to find these words, the epistle of Paul to the Hebrews. And very often, we would either ignore this title or assume that it's correct. Paul wrote letters to the Romans and the Corinthians and the Ephesians and the Galatians and the Colossians. Why not to the Hebrews? Well, all of those other letters actually say that they were written by Paul. Hebrews makes no such claim. In fact, Hebrews makes no claims of authorship whatsoever. It's an anonymous letter written to those whose ancestors God spoke to through the prophets. That's all we can actually know for sure. And its style is actually very different from the style that we find in Paul's letters. So not only is there no reason to think that Paul wrote Hebrews, we now know that almost certainly he did not. It's actually said that the letter, or the name of the author of this letter, was blotted out for reasons that have come or not come down to us at all. We do not know why, if the name was blotted out, why the name of the author was blotted out. But one of the reasons suggested by some scholars is that the actual author was a woman named Priscilla. And these are not crackpot scholars. These are very, very good scholars with excellent reputations. They have investigated the place and time that they know Hebrews came from, and they have arrived at this suggestion for a very good reason, and others of equal reputation back them up. And the fact that the author was, for some reason, covered up does, in fact, give us reason to wonder why. And the fact that the author's name was blotted out or covered up might well be because it was written by a woman. So let's drop the notion that the author might have been Paul and simply receive this letter in Jesus' name and be thankful for whoever it was that wrote it. In today's passage from the 10th chapter that Ginger just read to us, I think we can quickly see that one of the reasons behind this letter, the letter to the Hebrews, it's addressing the Christian faith from a very Hebrew point of view in order to help explain why we Christians believe what we do. Traditionally, we believe that Hebrews was written around 30 years after Jesus' death and resurrection, that is, before the destruction of the temple, the Jewish temple, by the Roman army. In Hebrews 10, we read a great deal about how the high priest enters the sanctuary of that temple, makes sacrifice, and sprinkles blood. And Hebrews argues that Jesus is the eternal high priest. When Hebrews mentions priesthood, it's talking about two different priesthoods. One is the earthly priesthood of the high priest of the Jewish people, and the other is stating that Jesus is the eternal high priest. And Hebrews also says that the purest and final sacrifice was Jesus' own body and blood. Any need for sacrifices after Calvary ended, and any need for a priesthood was also ended, because Jesus performed both functions once and for all time. So, let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, says the writer of Hebrews, for the one who has promised is faithful. Here, she or he settles the minds of the readers and turns, however briefly, to a different topic. Now, there's a movement that we can see here, and it's a movement that we can see in both Paul's letters. You can see it certainly in the letter to the Romans, and you also see it very clearly in the book of James, that's a letter that was written by a completely different apostle, namely James, the brother of Jesus. So Hebrews is in good company in this sense. It goes from one thing to another, and that is the relationship between what we believe and what we do. I want to share with you a little experience here that I promise, at least I hope, will end up making sense in context. This happened a little over 20 years ago now. I was pastoring a church in Bogota, Colombia. Specifically, this happened in a cafeteria line. It's an odd thing to remember, but I remember it like it was yesterday. Now, I never studied Spanish a day in my life, so my Spanish at this point was pretty simple, pretty basic, and I might have understood the simplest way to say certain things, but anything beyond that was always going to be something brand new to me, often confusing, and just as often fascinating. So here I was in a cafeteria line, me on one side and the cafeteria workers on the other. And when I got to the soup lady, she asked me a strange question. Now, I was getting used to the fact that people down there often added rice to their soup, whether it had it or not already. They would often add rice to their soup. But she did not ask me if I wanted it in a way that I expected. I knew how to say, ¿Quiere arroz?, which means, do you want rice? And I might even at that point have been able to stretch my knowledge to the question, ¿Le gustaría arroz?, which means, would you like rice? But I was totally taken aback when the woman looked at me and asked me, ¿Le provoca arrocito?, which literally means, does a little rice provoke you? I had always thought of the verb to provoke as meaning to make angry. And so my first thought was, why would a little rice upset me so much? But of course, after my first moment of surprise, I realized that she was just asking me in a very idiomatic way if this rice appealed to me, if the idea of a little rice in my soup appealed to me, or going back to my most basic way of speaking, did I want rice? The word provoke obviously doesn't always mean provoke in a bad way. Sometimes it's quite good. And here in Hebrews, the writer means it in a very positive sense. The word they use is actually more violent than our word provoke. It is paroxysmos. There we go. Paroxysmos, which is the Greek word. And it's the Greek word that gives us our term paroxysm, which is a sort of attack, isn't it? Paroxysm is not generally a good thing. It's sort of an attack. And here, however, it doesn't really mean attack. It means to stir up. So Hebrews 10:24 says this. Let us consider how to provoke one another or to stir one another up to love and good deeds. Since God is so generous, and because the sacrifice of Christ has freed us from our bondage to sin, let's move on from there to encouragement. That's what's happening in this passage that Ginger read to us just a little bit ago. We've moved on from our sin due to the sacrifice of Christ. We're moving on to encouragement. We no longer have to argue about theology. Instead, let's egg each other on to help one another and our neighbors in the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ. Now, we can't encourage each other if we don't have anything to do with each other. We cannot encourage each other if we're never together. So the next thing Hebrews tells us is not to neglect coming together. Now this has always been a nice Bible verse. It encourages people to come to church on Sundays. And I'm sure I have used it myself in the past in sermons. Do not neglect to come together. But it took on a whole new significance last year during the COVID lockdown. Many pastors and churches used this verse as a reason, and I'm going to put this strongly, as a reason to endanger public health by holding meetings when the rest of the country was doing everything possible to avoid doing anything that might spread the virus. Our church, indeed most churches in our two traditions, the UCC and the DOC, kept worship to remote gatherings. Yes, we gathered together, but we gathered on Zoom and on YouTube. Looking at the context of the verse in question, it's obvious that the Bible is not making the act of coming together physically a religious requirement. God can just as easily love us and save us from our homes as God can love us and save us when we're all in the same room. The writer of Hebrews was making a point, and the point that the writer of Hebrews was making is that our coming together helps us provide encouragement to one another. Now, I know that many of you did feel discouraged during the lockdown, and for that, I apologize. The elders and I truly did try to keep everyone in prayer and in the loop and in loving contact with each other and with their church. I know that what we did not meet everyone's needs, but we were certainly more successful than some of the other churches I know of, those that did not even try. We set up call lists. We sent out continual emails once or twice a week at the minimum. I produced and uploaded worship videos at least once a week. And in every way possible that I know of, we provoked each other to love and good deeds, not from the same room, because we did not feel that was the responsible thing to do, but from all over the county. Now, God works within and among us in some pretty amazing ways. We look forward to the day when separation and discouragement and misunderstanding end. And this is how the reading from Hebrews today ended as well. But until then, we gather in this sanctuary and we watch and listen from our homes as we encourage one another, as we stir one another up to find new ways to love and serve the people of this congregation, of the church around the world, and of our us never neglect this kind of togetherness. Amen.
Because the Bible tells us that it is more blessed to give than to receive, we celebrate God's blessing by rising in body or spirit to sing the doxology as the deacons bring forward.
And minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Go in the strength of God and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and may God be with you and remain with you both now and forevermore.